Tonight, we're going to be talking about budget and financial oversight as a job of school boards. Our crew tonight are myself, Susan Holson. I'm the Director of Education Services here at VSBA. I'm joined tonight by my colleague, Sue Siglowski, the Director of Legal and Policy Services. Sue, are you there?
Yes, I am.
And Carrie Lamb, our Director of Operations.
Good evening, everyone.
For those of you who have joined us before for webinars, you know how this works. We have a PowerPoint presentation that will appear on the screen. On your screen, you have a question box. We rely on that for your questions, which are welcome throughout the webinar. We have a couple of spots where we will take time to answer them, but if something comes up in the moment, please jump in and ask your question. We do it that way rather than having everybody's mics turned on, because we are going to have about 50 people on tonight and that would just get really cumbersome. When the webinar is over, you'll be directed to an evaluation form. We really rely on your input, and so we are hopeful that you'll take a couple of minutes to give us your feedback on the webinar so we can continue to improve the services that we offer to our members. At the beginning of next week, you will each receive an email follow-up that gives you a summary of what we talked about tonight. You'll get the PowerPoint slides, you'll get whatever handouts we're using or referencing, and you'll also get a link to the recorded version of the webinar. And all of our webinars are archived both on our website and on the VSBA YouTube channel. So if there's ever a topic you're looking for a little brush up, check it out. So tonight we're going to start by talking about the roles and responsibilities of school board members and the school board as an entity, the administration, and the treasurer with respect to the financial process and financial monitoring. Then for those of you who are feeling a little bit uneasy about how to read a financial statement, we'll do a couple of exercises around that, and then we'll talk about best practices in financial monitoring to make sure that you're getting the information you need in your job as board members. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Sue Siglowski, and she will take us through the legal and practical definitions of who does what with finance.
Thank you, Susan. Good evening, everyone. We're going to begin by talking about the role of the school board in financial oversight and budget. The board is accountable to taxpayers to ensure that there is financial oversight of expenditures versus the budget, and this is accomplished by periodic monitoring. The board's role in financial oversight is to ensure that resources are used to accomplish the board's mission. In order to ensure the financial health of the district, the board reviews financial statements and compares those statements to the budget, and also hires an independent auditor. The role of the board in authorizing expenditures is set forth in 16 VSA section 563 subsection 8. One of the duties of school boards is authorization of expenditures, and this law allows a board to authorize a committee, the superintendent, or an employee of the board to examine the bills and prepare the orders. This authorization is an alternative to the full board examining the bills and signing the orders at each meeting. The SU or SD board also has financial oversight responsibilities. These include the requirement that it employ a person qualified to provide financial management services for the SU or SD, and if applicable, to the member districts. The law also requires each SU or SD board to provide services to member districts in a manner that promotes the efficient use of financial resources. 16 VSA section 261A subsection 8 includes a list of services each SU or SD board is required to provide. And we've listed on this slide those services that are related to finances. The superintendent is the chief executive officer of the supervisory union, and he or she is required to carry out the policies of the school boards relating to the educational or business affairs of the SU or SD, and is also responsible for the general supervision of the public schools in the district, in the SU or SD. In terms of business affairs, this includes preparing monthly orders, sending checks to the treasurer for signature and distribution, maintaining and reconciling the general ledger, and preparing monthly financial statements.
Sue, if I can just cut in here.
Sure.
These are statutory responsibilities of the superintendent, but the superintendent can delegate these to staff members or other people in the district. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so that's where the business officers would come in and bookkeepers, et cetera.
Right.
Okay.
We'll move on now to the role of the treasurer. In town school districts, the town treasurer is also the school district treasurer, unless the electorate elects someone else to the position. A school board member may not serve as treasurer for his or her board. The duties of the treasurer include signing checks as authorized by the board or its designee, investing funds in a prudent manner, and reconciling monthly accounts with the SU or SD. The roles of the school board, superintendent, and treasurer provide a set of internal controls which protect public money. The school board approves expenditures, the superintendent's office prepares orders and checks, and the treasurer releases the funds.
And that's a good protection because that means nobody's double duty.
Right. So at this point, we'd like to take a poll and ask you who signs the warrant, or also called the orders, for your board. Is it the superintendent, the board chair or clerk, the full board, other, or don't know?
Okay, so what we're seeing here is that only one of you responded that the superintendent is signing the orders, and the rest of you split pretty evenly between the full board and some board member. And there was one response that there were two board members were required to look at that. How much time is your board taking out of every meeting to be reviewing these orders? We do know that there are boards around the state that are spending a lot of board meeting time to review and discuss and sign off on the warrants. And that's just a really inefficient use of board time. You've got more important matters to attend to because this is a checks and balances system. So we will talk more about that as the evening continues. Thank you for participating.
So now we'll talk about the audit. The SU or SD board is responsible for ensuring that there's an annual audit of the financial statements and practices of the SU or SD and any member districts. The superintendent also completes an internal controls checklist per the state auditor of accounts. The annual audit report is a public document which is available for inspection and copying. And at this point, we'll open it up for any questions on the information that we've covered so far regarding board, treasurer, and superintendent's office responsibilities.
I see no questions just yet.
Okay. I'll turn it back over to you, Susan.
Okay. We'll move on. If questions occur as we're going along, please feel free to chime in, even if they're on something that we're past. So the best practices recommendations for financial reporting, and some of this is outlined in statute as well, is that there needs to be an accounting of expenditures, or as the government likes to call them, appropriations, that would include your budget, any authorized transfers or adjustments to that budget, and then expenditures to date, identifying both monies that are already committed, those would be encumbered funds, and thus the remaining balance of unencumbered funds. And the revenue accounts, which the board really has less to do with in general, are the estimated revenues, which are built into your budget as well, the amounts you've received to date, and the estimates of what you expect to be receiving in the rest of the fiscal year. Just by way of giving a bit of a glossary here for those of you who are not accustomed to scrutinizing financial statements, the primary statement that we're going to focus on tonight is the the expenses portion of what would traditionally be called an income statement. A few things are particularly noteworthy here, so I want to take the time to define them. One is the time period. It's really important to know what period of time the statements that you're analyzing cover, because that has implications for performance. And in case you're not comfortable with it, YTD is a very commonly used abbreviation, meaning year to date. So if you're looking at statements at any point in your fiscal year, you're going to have a year-to-date actual amount. The budget is an annual number that's been adopted by the board and approved by the electorate. Here's a bit of a discrepancy, which we will talk about at length, but you've got some timing issues factored in here. So you're looking at an annual budget and you're looking at year-to-date expenditures. And so how do you judge what you're really looking at? How do you analyze that? The actual numbers reflect what's really happening, and you'll be presented with a comparison to budget known as a variance. And as I said before, encumbered funds are funds that are committed even if they have not yet left the bank account. So typically that would be debt service and insurance payments, which you're contracted for and you know are coming on a given schedule. It's very fixed. They're not going to fluctuate. And so you need to make sure you have funds available for them. And the reporting of the financial statements varies all over the place. And what's most important is that these are consistent with any given board's policies.
Russell asks, what is the statute that governs the financial reports provided to the board? And is it required to obtain competitive bids for the audit?
I will check on the question about competitive bids for the audit, and we'll answer that later. The first part of the question was, what is the statute that governs the financial reports?
Correct.
There isn't a statute that provides specific reports. While Susan's talking, I can find the statutory language that covers this issue, but I don't think it is extremely specific.
Okay, great. So this is a sample made up operating expenses report, departmental operations. And what you see here is the annual fiscal 18 budget, fiscal 18 year to date actual, and the variance. So the key questions to ask yourself here are, first of all, what is the time period? March 31st, we're looking at the budget, the actual, and the variances. And the questions here really are, what are you seeing? What are you gaining from this? As a board that's monitoring finances, what are you learning from seeing this? Well, I'll give you a hint. Not much, because you're looking at 3/4 of a year, but you're comparing 3/4 of a year actual expenses to an annual budget and seeing the amount of money that hasn't been spent yet. But you don't know if you're on target or not on target based on what you're seeing here. So another way to look at that, and the way we would sooner recommend, is to look at it both in terms of the annual budget and the year-to-date actual, the encumbered amount, which remember we talked about is those amounts that are already committed. The budget minus the actual and the encumbered gives you what your year-to-date unencumbered balance is, and then looking at that as a percent of your budget gives you some guidelines. So you've got 25% of your year left. March 31st is 3/4 of the way through your fiscal year. And so any of those unencumbered percentages that are less than the 25% of the year that's still remaining are things that you might want to get a little bit more explanation about from your finance people. Generally speaking, when you get these statements, you should get with them a report that will explain why you're seeing the kinds of variances or the kinds of gaps that are evident in the report. So for example, if we're looking across this line down near the bottom, transportation, let's look at the very last line. You had an annual budget of $172,500. Your actual to date is $129,000. But look at this large encumbered amount. Maybe there was some serious maintenance issues that happened on some of the buses that you had not anticipated, had not budgeted for, but now are committed to paying. And so you end up with this fairly substantial negative number in your transportation budget. You have overspent or anticipate overspending your transportation budget for the year. In and of itself, that's a bit of a problem. It's an issue certainly worth noting. And that's where you're going to go back to your administrator and ask, how are we going to manage this? Where is that money going to come from? Because at the end of the year, you really need to be at and or within your budget. So there may be some other areas here where you can give a little bit. And that's the dance that starts to happen. In the very beginning of the year, you're not going to have a sense of that yet, but it's important to keep watching month after month or quarter after quarter, depending on your policy, as to how often you're reviewing this.
Susan?
Yes.
A board member named Jim has said that they get estimates of full year results at mid-year based on year to date. And the encumbered and the estimated remainder of the year from their business manager.
That's great. And if everybody got that, that would be terrific. What we have noticed is that practices really vary from board to board as to how much information, the timing of information, and quite honestly, the value of the information that's being presented to the boards. So having that projection helps a lot. Of course, you're reliant on the people who are handling the numbers and handling the money to know what to anticipate. And it's not a perfect science, but it is a bit of an art. Thank you for that, Jim. That's really helpful to point out what it is boards want to be looking at. So taking this one step further, this is a handout I encourage you to really utilize on an ongoing basis as a board. These are the questions that you want to be asking. And there are columns here. You can put in the date of the report that you're seeing. And, you know, is this the right frequency of reporting? Do you want monthly statements? Are quarterly good enough? If you're going to get a projection, is 6 months the right time for that? What's going to really help you do your job? Perhaps the most critical question is, how are we doing relative to our budget? That's really, at the end of the day, you've got that much money and only that much money that's been appropriated by your electorate. And that's the money that you are in the dialogue with the state to get back from the education fund. So are you going to make it through the year? If there are any large variances, that is differences from what you anticipated in your budget, the big question here is not why is there a big variance, although you're certainly entitled to know that information and likely will know that information. The bigger question really is, what action is management taking to compensate for that or address that variance? So if, for example, it turns out we had a really, really snowy year and the budget for plowing and salting has gone through the roof, completely unanticipated and unavoidable. So what's management going to do about that, both in the short term for this budget year, and how are you going to plan for next year? And finally, are the statements formatted in a way that informs the board about the financial health of the district? And this is where some of those timing gaps come into play. Again, the biggest job you have here really is to probe the plans for addressing the variances and to make sure you're seeing what you need to see in order to be able to do your job of oversight. Your job here is oversight. It's not deciding how to spend each line item. That's the administration's job. The board's job is the fiscal responsibility to your taxpayers. Does anybody have questions about what it is you're looking for when you're reading a financial statement, or what it is you need to know from that statement in order to perform your job?
Susan, while we're waiting, I could give some information regarding the previous question.
Excellent.
The question was the statute that contains the form or the financial reports that the board should be receiving. And it's a couple of different statutes address this. For a supervisory union board, it's 16 VSA section 261A, subsection 8, which says that that board should provide the following services for the benefit of the member districts, and one of those services is financial services. And then if you take a look at 16 VSA section 563, subsection 8, that is the power of school boards, and it says shall establish and maintain a system for receipt, deposit, disbursement, accounting, control, and reporting procedures that meets the criteria established by the state board pursuant to subdivision 164, subsection 15 of this title. So the state board has set up some criteria, and those are the criteria for these reporting procedures.
Right, but that doesn't really address the specific reports, which I think was the question. And I'm not surprised, because I don't think that is found in statute. Where you'll find that is in policy. And so let's go on and talk about best practices, and that really is seated in a district's policy. So we have two recommended financial policies, which will be in your packets. Model policy F20 is the fiscal management and general financial accountability policy. And that delineates what the administrative responsibilities are, establishing and maintaining the accounting system. And again, we're giving a broad definition to administration here. The administration is also charged with the control of district finances, the internal controls, and the reporting of school district finances, both to the board and to meet the state obligations that are put on a district. That policy also speaks to the guidelines that the board sets relative to expenditures. So the board can put a limit on how much the superintendent is authorized to spend, even if it's a budgeted item. You may want to say, you know, superintendent can't authorize a single expenditure of more than $10,000 without board approval. build that into your policy. Similarly, as the year goes on, just like in your personal finances, some days you're going to find you're spending more on one thing than you expected to and less on something else. And the superintendent, according to policy, may or may not have latitude to do that. And if so, there may be a limit on the amount that he or she is able to transfer from one line to another in the financial statements. So those two things get specified, and also delegation of specific accounts. For example, the annual audit. It's in statute that the board must take on an audit, but it can be delegated to the administration to choose the auditor and initiate the process, as long as the board gets evidence that it's being done and, of course, receives that final audit report. The other policy that we include in our model policy manual and highly recommend is this one, to answer the earlier question about financial reports and statements. So the second model policy is about financial reports and statements. It's necessary to have the information to inform the board and also to demonstrate accountability, and for the board to be able to demonstrate accountability to the taxpayers. The reports submitted by administration that we recommend as part of your policy is an appropriations account. That would be your expenditures, including any revisions that are being made as per the previous policy that we were just talking about, and revisions to those appropriations. So your expenditures to date, what you know of as outstanding encumbrances, and what's available to be dispersed for the remainder of the period. And again, when those come to the board, they usually come with explanations about the irregularities. Similarly, a treasurer's report is appropriate for the board to get, maybe monthly, maybe quarterly, that you decide in your policy. That treasurer's report is really about your bank book, your cash on hand at the beginning and the end of the period, to the receipts by service area, and the disbursements, that the checks that have been written. And the treasurer is also responsible for indicating that, in fact, the bank statements have been reconciled.
Susan, we have a couple questions.
Great, because guess what? That was the next slide. Oh,
wonderful. So Meg's wondering, can the board give input to management about how to address a deficit situation?
If management is asking for it, sure. But in the course of typical board responsibilities, that really is outside the scope of the oversight that we expect from the board.
Okay, we have one more question from Jim. Isn't the state requiring all districts to move to a single designated, same for all accounting system within a year or so?
It is my understanding, Jim, that in fiscal 2020, which is a year away, there will be some standardization through the state so that all of the reports delivered to the state will have consistency. And by virtue of using their system for that, yes, there will be much more consistency across the board than there is today.
And that's all the questions we have right now.
Okay. Well,
just a second. I just got another one. Peter wants to know, says somewhat off topic, are there guidelines on how much treasurers should be paid?
Boy, I have not seen any guidelines. Sue, can you chime in on that one? Do you know anything about that?
No, I haven't seen anything about how much they should be paid. I do know, for example, for a supervisory union treasurer, 16 VSA Section 322, Subsection A says that the Supervisory Union Board shall elect a Supervisory Union Treasurer at least annually, fix the salary and expenses, and determine the amount of a bond for him or her. So it is, in that instance, it is fixed by the Supervisory Union Board, but it doesn't give any guidance as to how much it should be.
I'm afraid that may not have been terribly helpful. Sorry. But I think that is one of those things that's really up to the individual board, and tradition probably influences that as much as anything. Are there any other questions? We are here. Please feel free to reach out with questions if they come to you after we disconnect from each other tonight. So, seeing no more questions, I would like to thank you very much for joining us this evening. I know another, even if it's 45 minutes out of an evening, you're all busy, and appreciate the time that you put in. And again, most of all, we thank you for serving on your school board and devoting yourself to your communities and your community's children. When we sign out here, as I mentioned earlier, you will receive a link to an evaluation. It's brief. Please give us that information and that feedback. It would be really helpful. And thank you very much for joining us tonight.